Next topic is on fluid management in a pediatric patient by Dr. Ankit Desai.
My next topic is fluid management in pediatric anesthesia. This is a slightly boring topic. There are no videos here. I have tried to make it and divide it into different categories of patients. Hopefully, you would be able to get a gist of it towards the end of the lecture. So I have no financial disclosures. The highlights of the lecture is, first we'll be discussing an elective case, then we'll be discussing an emergency case, then we'll be discussing with examples why we need to give liberal clear fluids to all children preoperatively. Then we'll be discussing in short about colloids that can be used in pediatric anesthesia, then blood and blood products, and if we have time we'll go in for the neonates, because I think madam would be taking a separate lecture on neonates. So I'll be just dealing in brief about the fluid management and how it is different in neonates. So we come to the first case scenario. I'll be dealing in case scenarios. So this is a 2-year-old male child posted for circumcision, is fit for anesthesia, no problems here. What are the fasting guidelines and does he require IV fluids? Routine IV fluids, how many of you are practicing? Like a child is posted for a simple surgery, you give IV fluids routinely. Everyone is doing that? Okay. So what are the guidelines and how we do it and how we do it differently? So these are the consensus guidelines for IV fluids. These are the European Society of Anesthesia guidelines in 2011. They had said that the fasting guidelines are 2 hours for clear fluids, 4 hours for breast milk, 6 hours for non-human milk and formula feeds and solids, and 8 hours, which we commonly forget, is for fatty foods. So if they have had fatty foods, then it is 8 hours. These were the 2011 guidelines. Now these guidelines were proposed because there are certain advantages with these guidelines. So with liberal guidelines, that is allowing clear fluids preoperatively up to 2 hours pre-op, it prevents dehydration and hypoglycemia. Children are less irritable. They may not have solid foods, but even if they are given water, they are less irritable. There's less vomiting, thirst, hunger and anxiety in these kind of children. But the problems are, you are many times it is not possible, especially in institutions or even in private practice. You get in late in some case, and these guidelines are not followed, and many times they are overstaffed. And what most of the studies nowadays, with the advent of ultrasound, what most of the studies have shown is clear fluids get emptied within say less than 1 hour. It takes just 30 minutes for clear fluids to get emptied from the stomach. So even if you have fasting of just 30 minutes for clear fluids, there will be no aspiration. So a number of studies had come up in the past 3-4 years which showed that the whatever fasting guidelines that we were following, especially for clear fluids, were not appropriate, and even 2 hours made the child very irritable. So these were the consensus statement on clear fluids. This was given by the Association of Pediatric Anesthesia of Great Britain and Ireland. So what they have said is, these are the recommendations. They have come up in May 2018. So up till 16 years of age, 0 to 16 years of age, all other guidelines remain the same, but for clear fluids it is just 1 hour. It is not 2 hours, and it is 1 hour. And there are certain contraindications for these. Where you would not use a 1 hour guideline is patients with gastroesophageal reflux disease, those with renal failure, severe cerebral palsy, some enteropathies, esophageal strictures, achalasia. All these patients you would use the usual guidelines, but in these patients you can allow clear fluids up to 1 hour preoperatively. Now, what are clear fluids? Anyone can define clear fluids? Yeah, so clear fluids are fluids when poured in a transparent glass of water, you should be able to read the newsprint through it. Those are clear fluids. So those can be allowed up till 1 hour prior. So the basis of these was the gastric emptying time for clear fluids is just 30 minutes, and what they found out was when glucose was added to this fluid, the gastric emptying time was actually faster, and the risk, there was hardly any risk of pulmonary aspiration, and the children were less irritable and thirsty. Another very important point was, whenever you give clear fluids up to 1 hour prior, there is no need for IV fluids for routine surgery. Remember, I always say this, IV fluid is a drug. It has to be prescribed and used very rationally. Whatever drug you use has its own set of side effects. Even a simple RL has its own side effects. So wherever possible, enteric route is the preferred route. So if you allow clear fluids up till say 1 hour prior, there is no need to give any IV fluids routinely. So how much we allow according to these guidelines? According to these guidelines, you can allow up to 3 ml per kg of sugared fluid preoperatively. And there is no need for additional IV fluids as we discussed for routine elective short surgeries. These are not meant for those longer surgeries or emergency surgeries. These are meant for only routine elective short surgeries like your herniotomy, circumcision, orchiopexy, where you can easily avoid. Body will easily compensate for it. With examples, I would be showing why you don't have to give IV fluids later in the lecture. So now we come to the case 2. Case 2 is a 5-year-old male. He is 15 kg. He is posted for an emergency surgery, a laparoscopic appendix. What IV fluids do you give and how will you manage fluids? Now what is a routine IV fluid that everyone uses over here? Is anyone using Isolite P? How many are using Isolite Ps over here? Good, at least no one has lifted his hand. Isolite P is something which you have to just throw away. You just don't have, if you see a patient coming with Isolite P, first thing we do is just throw off the pint and start some RL or something. There is no role for Isolite P in pediatric anesthesia or any form of anesthesia. So these are the guidelines. These are 2018, just 2 months back, American Academy of Pediatrics has come up with these guidelines. These guidelines were meant for pediatricians. What we have seen is the problem is not with the anesthetist nowadays. Nowadays, anesthetists are routinely using isotonic fluids, but pediatricians still continue to use Isolite Ps or your 0.2% NS, which are hypotonic fluids, and they tend to cause a lot of hyponatremia in the perioperative period. So even pediatricians need to be trained about it. So what they have said is you have to totally avoid hypotonic fluids and use only isotonic fluids during the entire maintenance of your perioperative period. So why IV fluids are needed during emergency surgery? So what is the basis of using IV fluids? IV fluids are meant to preserve the child's extracellular volume. They prevent volume depletion. Also, you must remember that in children, you have to avoid fluid overload. You have to avoid electrolyte imbalance. And as I said, IV fluids have their own benefits and harm. There is a proper indication for IV fluids. So this is a slide which everyone must remember. IV fluids must be prescribed, ordered, dosed and delivered like any other drug. IV fluid is a drug. IV fluids have to be prescribed and used very, very rationally. So any resuscitation for emergency cases, you have 4 phases. There is a resuscitative phase, which is the boluses that you give. So whatever depletion that child has had, maybe due to vomiting or any other kind of losses, that you have to cover. The second phase is the titration phase, which is a transition between your bolus and your maintenance phase. Then there is your maintenance phase and the convalescent phase towards the end. That is after postoperatively, when the child starts from exogenous fluids to his enteric route, that is an intrinsic fluid balance. So there are 4 phases in any fluid administration. Now we all know this formula. The serum osmolality depends on sodium, BUN and glucose. So these are the fluids that tonicity of the fluids. If you can see the 0.2% NS, which is commonly used by pediatricians, the osmolality is just 78. So it tends to cause dilutional hyponatremia, which is the commonest iatrogenic electrolyte imbalance seen in the perioperative period. So that has to be totally thrown off and it is not to be used. Even with 0.45 NaCl, which is commonly used, if you add dextrose to it, then the osmolality is similar to 298. But dextrose immediately gets used up and the osmolality becomes 154, as you can see. So it is a hypotonic fluid. So it should be avoided. So the only 2 fluids which are good fluids are Ringer lactate and plasmalite. Also, Ringer lactate is slightly hypotonic. It is just slightly hypotonic. NS is slightly hypertonic, but plasmalite is the most ideal fluid. But the problem with plasmalite is the studies in pediatric patients are not there still. They are still coming up. So in less than 3 years, even the company people don't recommend using plasmalites as a routine IV fluid. So we still continue to use RL as our fluid of choice, because that is the fluid which most closely resembles our intracellular milieu. So this is the slide that I think everyone should remember. Ringer lactates is the gold standard. For minor fluids, you just have to allow, for minor cases, you have to allow clear fluids up to 1 hour prior to surgery, and you don't need any form of IV fluids. For major cases, we generally tend to give RL around in the bolus of around 20 to 40 ml per kg. No holiday cigar formula ever is required. If at all you use holiday cigar formula, holiday cigar himself has changed his original formula. The original formula was a 4-to-1 formula, which is commonly taught to us. He has himself changed it and said that the 4-to-1 formula causes a lot of hyponatremia, and the formula that we use nowadays is 2105. So 4-to-1 formula is not used any longer. It is the 2105 formula that is used for maintenance. It is not for initial resuscitation. For initial resuscitation, we use 20 to 40 ml per kg of a isotonic fluid, which is Ringer lactate or normal saline, 0.9% normal saline. Now Isolite P, as I said, it is to be thrown off from the OT. Initially they used to feel that it contains glucose, it contains various other electrolytes, magnesium, phosphate, so it may be the fluid of choice, but it causes this is hyponatremia, which is the most common electrolyte imbalance seen in a hospital admitted patient. And there are two important causes for it. One is hypotonic fluids, all your isolites, isolate G, M, P, all are equally bad. They are hypotonic fluids and they cause a lot of dilutional hyponatremia. And second is in the post-operative period, you see a state of inappropriate ADH or antidiuretic hormone, which is very commonly seen. It is due to arginine vasopressin hormone, which is in excessive quantities, and it causes an SIADH like state, which causes hyponatremia. So hyponatremia is commonly seen in post-operative periods because of pain, nausea, stress, post-operative state, a number of medications cause it, and patients with pulmonary and CNS disorder have this state. So in addition to this SIADH state, if you are giving hypotonic fluids, then it only worsens your situation. So you must always use only isotonic fluids. So now coming to hyponatremia. Hyponatremia by definition is less than 135 millimoles per liter. As we discussed, it is the most common iatrogenic electrolyte imbalance. You may see very non-specific signs with hyponatremia. Patients may come up with just nausea, vomiting, or straight away they may go in encephalopathy, seizures, and respiratory arrest. Remember, hyponatremia is a medical emergency. Patient, whenever you see hyponatremia, a patient has to be immediately transferred to the PICU. He cannot be managed in the ward. So the management for it is 0.6 into body weight into 130 minus present sodium. So that is how you treat it. We will not go into too much details because we have to cover a lot. So just remember, 1 ml per kg of 3% NS, which is used for treatment of hyponatremia, builds the sodium levels by 1 millimoles per liter. You have to do it very slowly. You don't do it very rapidly. And once the child becomes asymptomatic, you shift from 3% NS to 0.9% NS. So now coming to this case, this I want to discuss in details. This is a 15 month old child posted for, is 10 kgs and is posted for a routine inguinal hernia, which is a routine elective case. Child is fasting since midnight. For some reasons, he is posted at 3 p.m. This is very commonly seen in any institutions, or many times in private practice also we see. So now what is the way you should go about? So now with 15 hours fasting, what is the fluid deficit? The fluid deficit by your traditional formula is around 15 into 10, 10 kg is his body weight into 4, which is 600 ml. A 10 kg child would have, 10 kg is roughly around 10 liters. So it, in a child, the body volume is around 70 to 80%. The water concentration, the total body water is 70 to 80%. So that is around 6000 ml. So 600 ml out of 6000 ml is around 10% deficit. So if he is kept fasted for say 15 hours, the deficit is around 10%. So here is a scenario where you have to give IV fluids. You cannot say that you will not give IV fluids, because I have told you to not give IV fluids only when liberal fluids are continued up to 1 or 2 hours prior to the anesthesia given. In this scenario, you have to give IV fluids. Now suppose at 11 a.m. you realize that the child is fasting since 12 midnight, and you want to take up the child at 1 p.m. So suppose if you continue and you don't give liberal fluids even at this stage, and you straight away take him directly without any clear fluids at 1 p.m. what is happening is, up to 11 p.m. is around say 10 or 11 hours, so that is 440 ml of deficit, plus another 2 hours for 1 a.m. so that is around 520 ml of deficit. So that comes to around roughly 10%. So deficit is still 10%. Now suppose at 11 a.m. you allow the child to have around 200 ml ml of clear fluids. So you just remove the deficit from it, that is 200 ml, so that the deficit straight away reduces from 10% to 5%. So just giving clear fluids would reduce the deficit by around 5%. So liberal fluids pre-op, that is clear fluids pre-op, is the only way you can reduce the deficit. If the child is left fasting, as we had discussed, the total deficit would be around 520 ml. And if he is taken up directly at 3 ml, it would increase to around 600 ml. So the deficit just keeps on increasing. So in this scenario, what would have been an ideal management? An ideal management would be 6 hours prior, just allow him to take a light breakfast and allow clear fluids till say up to 1 hour prior, that is around 2 p.m. So if that is the case, the fasting is just 1 hour. So the total deficit is 4 into 10 is body weight. Into 1, where is the 1 hour, so it's just 40 ml, so the deficit is just 0.6%. so if the deficit is just 0.6%, the body is easily able to compensate and you don't need any IV fluid. So that is the reason you allow clear fluids in the pre-operative period up to 1 hour prior. I hope I am clear why I am stressing on this point. Just allow clear fluids up to 1 or 2 hours prior to the surgery. This is very important in pediatrics and it is the only effective way of maintaining his extracellular fluid volume. Now coming to colloids in peds, there are two types of colloids. One is the natural proteins and other is the synthetic colloids, which we commonly have in the OT. Now the natural proteins are albumin, which are available in various concentrations from 5 to 20%. Then there is a fresh frozen plasma, which is commonly seen in used in the neonatal age group, and stabilized human serum, of which albumin is the most preferred colloid. It is a 5% albumin is the most physiological. It is an isotonic fluid. It is the least allergenic. It is a bit expensive, and remember, albumin is contraindicated in traumatic brain injuries because it can cause CNS damage, because the cerebral blood flow, auto-regulation is disturbed. Now FFP was routinely used, even we used to use it very routinely when I started practicing, but with FFP you have to remember it's a blood product. It is hypertonic, it causes a lot of hypernatremia, it has allergic potential, and the incidence of TRALI or transfusion related acute lung injury is the highest with the use of fresh frozen plasma. Hence nowadays we prefer using 5% albumin over FFP. So the preferred colloid in pediatric age groups is 5% albumin. Also viruses like HIV, HCV can get transmitted because it is a blood product. Coming to synthetic products, there are two synthetic products which are available, your starches and gelatins, which currently the starches are the preferred ones. Gelatin keeps changing. You come up many new studies keep coming that gelatin is preferred and hydroxyurea starch, but we commonly use around 5% starches as a choice in older children, not in neonates. In neonates, 5% albumin is the preferred colloid. Now coming to blood products, important thing to remember is greater than 10 hemoglobin, you don't need to give any transfusion. Less than 6, you are absolutely sure you need transfusions if it is for an elective case. If it is an emergency case, if it is an elective case, then of course you can postpone it, start some iron or something, and you increase the hemoglobin to at least 8 before you proceed with the procedure. So between 6 to 10 is the gray area. The gray area that you have to individualize, it depends on the surgery. So suppose if you have a child with 8 gram hemoglobin, is posted for a routine circumcision, then rather than giving blood products, I would rather do the case. So it's, you cannot give blood products to a child posted for a routine surgery at 8 gram hemoglobin. So you have to individualize and do what is the best for the child. So this is a estimated blood volume. There are many complex formulae. Just remember, any blood or any blood products, there is a rule of 10. You have to give 10 ml per kg. So blood, you have to give 10 ml per kg per day. Platelets, you can give 10 to 15 ml per kg. And FFP, you have to give 10 to 15 ml per kg. So per day dose for all blood and blood products is 10 ml per kg. So coming to the last case is the neonates. Remember, neonates are different, and in neonates, preterm neonates are still different. So their fluid management is different from a routine child. So this is just discussing this case. I think Rushali madam will also be discussing this kind of case in neonatal emergencies, but I will be just covering the fluid management in this. So this is a day 20 child, male child, who is lethargic. His capillary refill time is 8 seconds, so he is obviously fluid depleted. Mother says she has not changed diapers in 6 hours and there is a mass in the abdomen. So the diagnosis is IHPS or congenital hypertrophic pyloric stenosis. This is his serum biochemistry. You can see that he is having hypochloremic alkalosis with hypokalemia. So how do you correct this the electrolyte imbalance? So as we discussed, the initial first case, first is the resuscitation phase. So resuscitation phase, you always give isotonic fluids. So you use RL or NS around 20 to 40 ml per kg in the initial phase, and then maintenance doses with your Holiday cigar formula. Generally we use, the originally it was 4 to 1, now as I said it becomes 2105 formula. So 2 ml per kg, so it's 3 kg, so 3 into 2 into, just increase the dose in 1.5 times, because he is fluid depleted and he is still losing fluids, he is still vomiting, and with vomiting, whatever amount of vomiting is the amount he is vomited, that you have to replace with RL. And also remember, you don't start potassium unless he has a urine output. So potassium and magnesium and other electrolytes are added only once he starts getting a urine output. So you proceed with an IHPS surgery. IHPS is a medical emergency, remember, it's not a surgical emergency. So it's a medical emergency. You have to stabilize the electrolytes first, and then you have to take up for surgery. If you don't stabilize the electrolytes and you proceed with the surgery, is not going to improve. So you have to need, at least the chloride should be above 100, the bicarbonate should be less than 28, and the base excess should be less than 2 before you proceed with the surgery. So now, how are neonates different? If you see neonates, this is the blue one, is the premature child. The premature child, they are basically a bag of water. The premature babies, the neonates, they are just a bag of water. So the extracellular fluid composition is up to 60% in a neonate. It is just 40% in term neonates, and in adults it reduces to around 20%, and obviously the intracellular fluid is lesser. So this is the body concentration. Now the total body water in a premature child is around 80%, whereas in neonates, in term neonates, it is around 70 to 80%, it's around 75%. With age, the concentration of total body water reduces to around 50 to 60%, which is in the adult age group. So this age group is just a bag of water. 80% of his body weight is just water, extracellular fluid, water. So they are just a bag of water. Even if you see the total body, protein concentration, it is much lesser, and with age it increases. The glomerular filtration, these things we have to remember, because any kind of drug we use, it depends on your glomerular filtration, your total proteins that are there in the neonates. So it takes around 6 months for the GFR to reach around 100 ml per kg. It's as low as 20 ml per kg per hour in premature neonates. So transitional circulation, I think madam has discussed in this in the video. So in a neonate, the fluid requirements on day 1 are minimal. On day 2 to day 3, they start getting a urine output. So diuresis of extracellular fluid begins, and day 4 to day 5, the urine output start increasing, and the fluid intake would depend on the urine output. So day 1, what most pediatricians give is 10% dextrose water. From day 2 onwards, they start giving fluids with electrolytes. Whereas in preterm neonates, they have a stable body weight and minimal urine output on day 1. The only difference between preterm neonate and your term neonates is the concentration of fat. You can see the concentration of fat, there is no concentration of fat in the preterm neonate. It increases, it is slightly higher in a term neonate. So when you have no fat, the evaporative losses are far higher in a preterm neonate. So that you have to compensate in preterm neonates. Now neonatal hypoglycemia, the sugar should be less than 45 is your neonatal hypoglycemia. Do you give routine glucose for neonates? Like, is routine glucose recommended even for neonates? Anybody using routine glucose? So there are certain indications where you have to give routinely glucose, like patients who are on hyperalimentation fluids, patients who are of diabetic mothers or premature babies, or even extensive regional anesthesia because there is no sympathetic stimulation. So in these cases, you need routine glucose management, routine glucose in their IV fluids. But in other patients, you need to monitor their glucose. You may not give glucose as a routine, but you need to monitor glucose, and if they are going in hypoglycemia, then you have to add glucose to their IV fluids. So this is the Holiday cigar rule. We have discussed this. The rule is not 4 to 1 now, it is 2, 1 and 0.5. So all neonates, it is important that you don't push fluids. You have to give through infusion pumps. Piggyback is a good way of using, of giving boluses. Use syringe meters. Maybe for blood products, you can use small syringes to measure the exact concentration. Or if you have an infusion pump, you can use infusion pumps. Hyperalimentation fluid should always be given through syringe pumps and need a separate line. Remember, hyperalimentation, whenever the child comes with hyperalimentation fluid to the OT, if you disconnect the hyperalimentation fluid, always add glucose to your IV fluids. Otherwise, routinely what we do is we reduce the dose of hyperalimentation fluid by one third to half of what he was getting pre-op. So then you do not need to add glucose as a routine in your IV fluid. You can use just RL as your IV fluid of choice. These are special cases, like say gastrostasis and omphalocele, which we hardly see nowadays because of antenatal detection. They have increased fluid requirements. Nowadays what we see is NECs, a lot of NECs where they require massive fluid, sometimes up to the extent of 40 ml per kg per hour in the initial period. And they also have DIC and thrombocytopenia, so they routinely require blood and blood products. Whenever you use FFP or platelets, always remember that they have a tendency to go in hypocalcemia, especially the neonates. They are more prone to hypocalcemia, and beware of hyperkalemia in cases like NEC. So my take home message is throw away all isolates. Any isolate coming to the OT, first thing you do is throw away and start some RL or something. Avoid all hypotonic fluids. Use liberal clear fluids up to 1 hour pre-op. RL or plasma light. Plasma light, some studies are needed, are the fluids of choice. Holiday cigar formula is 2105. Do not use 421 formula. And for blood and blood products, use 10 ml per kg as your standard formula for giving blood products. Remember this, primum non nocere. It means first do no harm. You have to select your IV fluids and use IV fluids as a drug. So first do no harm. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ankit, for the laboratory lecture. It was really very